I'm waiting on.
Hi, folks, how you doing? Good morning. I need coffee, really bad. Welcome to Culturebot, to our conversations here with the Under the Radar Festival. Under the Radar has been working with Culturebot for like 3 years now, Andy, designing these conversations. And there have been amazing conversations there, really taking a lot of life, and I've been really proud of it. This is being streamed live up into that web thing. And so just know that you're here with someone you aren't supposed to be here with or something. take that into consideration. So Andy, would you want to just start this? Thanks again for coming. Move in. Andy will tell you how the table works and what the conversation is today. But thanks a lot. And this is the last one for this year.
Yeah.
And then we'll do it again next year.
Right. Oh, all right. I'm holding you down.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Here we go.
Thank you. All right. Good morning, everyone. Or afternoon, I guess, technically. So first off, why doesn't everyone just move in, move the circle in closer? Because we got, if you guys want to kind of like, because it works best when everyone can kind of hear what's going on. And so, if you're running, you guys come down this way a bit. In fact, given the that's pretty good. And then if people come in, they can go in here. So we're going to be using a, first of all, I'm sort of combining things. I want to thank Mark, everyone, a big hand for Mark Russell. Culturebot wouldn't exist without Mark. I was working for Mark 10 years ago at PS122, and he gave me free leave to pursue this ridiculous blog that the kids were into. And lo and behold, 10 years later, here we are. So I thank Mark very much for making my life possible in this sector. Today we're going to use a format known as the long table. It was invented or created or devised or whatever by Lois Weaver, who's an immensely talented theater artist. She, along with Peggy Shaw and Deb Margolin, started something called Split Bridges back in the 80s at the WOW Theater down the street. And she's been doing excellent work in creating non-hierarchical, democratic forms of discourse. This is one that she came up with. We've modified it a little. Hers is totally democratic. And she doesn't, she just puts the table out and invites whoever. I like to invite people, because we're tackling some pretty big ideas. We invite people to sort of seat the table. But the way it works is like there's open seats. So if you feel moved to speak, please come to the table. If you feel moved to speak and there's not a seat at the table, you're welcome to tap somebody out. They are welcome to refuse to give you their seats. If you're at the table, the only real rule is you have to be at the table to speak. So don't speak from the circle. You have to actually come up to the table. Or even if you just want to come up to the table and listen from the table, that's cool too. Come on in. Oh, hey. Everybody has bios in the, all the invited guests have bios in the program, so we're going to dispense with that. Today, there's etiquette guides to the long table. I think they got handed out. And today, what are we talking about? American humor? Oh, we're talking about American theater and the aesthetics of modern theater. And it's kind of the, so we'll just get into it,
Hey, how's everybody doing? So one of the reasons I like to hang out with a bunch of people all at the same time, I don't know everything. But in the lead up to this, I actually want to start with our discussion a little bit, because I'm just going to be perfectly, looking around. Of the four conversations, this is the whitest this room has been. Through the course of the Brooklyn Commune Project, we really had, the Brooklyn Commune Project is a grassroots project that's right, we have had really the past four discussions here very diverse. You know, we had a lot of people that gave a lot of different perspectives. I really worked with on the project and say, you know, actually, although we extended invitations to many people, it was hard, it's been harder sometimes to get diverse perspectives to the table and we talked about in different contexts. So I wanted to sort of integrate in a separate thing this idea of invitation. And when we talk about making democracy happen, we talk about how aesthetics and democracy and theater and people work all kind of together, I think about this idea of invitation. Of how do we, at first, I, you know, how do we invite each other to make other practices? How do we create spaces that feel inviting, create conversations that feel inviting? How do we, you know, Kyung's not here, obviously, where he was able to talk about this pretty well as part of this research. But I think a lot about this, like how do we, you know, and Allison, where are you? Did you come to the table? Because I want to talk also about when we met the other night and we were talking about, you know, well, you wrote a report. And a lot of, like, we wrote a report. And a lot of the, Allison, just one comment. Allison was at the settlement house, University Settlement, of course. And I was just thinking about, you know, invitation there, and we have a lot of good events there. And yet, you know, the reason we happened there is that your institution started coming. Anyway, I just sort of wanted to open up that question because you talked about invitation.
It's a really complicated. I feel like I spend. I'm a maker. I have a theater company called The Foundry, and I make theater in lots of different positionalities. And I think I spend a lot of time wondering how to invite people. I just had a really interesting argument with Morgan about invitation the other day because it contains within it also a positionality, like I'm inviting you.
Empowerment.
Yeah, well, I don't know if it's empowerment. If you're making an invitation,
what often do we talk about invitation? It's an invitation. It's an invitation. It's an
empowerment. I don't agree because I understand the positionality. I understand it as a positionality. Like I'm doing something. Would you like to be a part of what I'm generating? Right? And that's the difficulty when you're making art and you're inviting people to come.
Okay. You're saying, I have the resources. I'm the one with the resources.
Yeah, but that's already problematic. Right? I mean, in a weird way. Well, that's the thing. So actually, let me just get to the end of this thought, and then I'll throw it in. The notion of invitation is, for me, and I don't have no answers whatsoever. I'm absolutely trying to figure out, honest to God, every day. It's, what is its direction? Like, where are you throwing it? How are you presenting yourself as transparently and meaningfully as possible in that invitation? So for example, we use a lot of questions when we're inviting people to things. We try to, I don't even think we know it, but we often start with certain questions because those are the questions that are generating the work and that everyone is grappling with. So throwing a question out in a certain way as part of the information is, I don't know, it feels at least like we mean it. But the problem is how muddy the water is with and how muddy language has been made by money. So words like, I was wondering if the word aesthetics in the invitation of this was an open enough word. I'm just saying, like, that's something you would go, should we use this word? It's well, what we mean, but how is it received in the world now?
I think it's a great question. You know, I think, you know, two things that come up, there are different people that people can address it differently. One is sort of like the whole model, like I'm going to put on a show and invite people to come to it, which is, you know, inherent. And the reason we do this structure of social panel discussion directly, not to do that. You know, this idea of presentation and invitation to come watch other people do something, and
this whole, you know, reminding us that, that before there was regional theater, there was little theater, there was community-based, as you said, locally responsive, a community-based, locally responsive model of theater. That sets up different conditions and invitation. It sets up relationship building. So if you're working with people who are geographically proximate, you quite naturally make relationships. And so you don't have to ask, you don't have to be the person in all your benevolence inviting someone else in. You can find that because of who you know, because your kids go to the same school, or you go to the same church, or you shop at the same supermarket or grocery store, you can find that you have interests in common, there are issues there, you end up wanting to make work, and you want to know what other people think, and you end up working together. So that's a kind of vitality, and I think that, again, going back to the our starting point here, I think we're in such an interesting moment with regional theaters where so many of them are looking back to the local.
Right.
This institution being one of them with, you know, local works and the work that they're doing with SMA, starting Michael Rowe does a lot of it. When Bill Rauch left Cornerstone to run the work on Shakespeare Festival, the biggest budget in the country, who'd have thought, you know, you go from. So there's clearly a desire to find meaning in common locally.
I totally agree in theory about it, that these things happen naturally, but, you know, when we're
I didn't say naturally.
Well, that they happen in your daily life.
Your relationship, build it, which is work.
Exactly. Yeah. But it's not hard, and that's what I mean, it's not easy, rather. But that model actually really hasn't served the assembly so well in the last 7 years that we've been together. We found, we thought, oh yes, you know, we're very diverse-minded people who really want and encourage diversity in the way that we that we work with, but as a result, we found that there was still, after 7 years of working together, we're an all-women company. And it didn't. It didn't. And we set up to think we're the kind of people who want that. So we decided to make it a much more overt objective recently, and it was not an easy choice to figure out how to really engage it on a more pragmatic level that policy, especially racial diversity that we really seek in the creation of a new play about blacks.
Also, yeah, time you to bring that together with what also important funding and what you know Janet's talking about. Yesterday we had a table with David, and Harrison from Movement Theater for a year. You know, and they just made a really lovely piece last year called Movements. And they couldn't get resources to save their lives, you know. And so they were like, we have all these great queer men of color that are our friends, you know, these writing goals. Sound installation of what I want to make something that does that with voices around me. They built it, worked up in Marlowe, and they built it with their local stakeholders, and they made a really wonderful piece of theater. They're very few people from this community actually go see. And you know, so the geographic proximity is actually a really key issue here, which is especially gentrifying New York, which as separate as practical. Class-based, race-based, cultural-based segregation goes into effect through development. I know that I'm not a phrase that in a loaded way, but I want to throw it to you because you guys.
I'm right there with you. So, I'm Sue, I'm the director of Cultural Star Theater. So, I think speaking to kind of both these topics of geographical location and the ease that we, I do feel we've been really lucky being in this wonderful. And really trying to learn the community and shape our programming in a responsible way that's answering both the downtown theater scene and the community that's around us. And we managed to do that. We're still learning all the time about an epidemic. It's certainly tricky and challenging and a wonderful problem, but I think because we have a venue, we're planted, and it's, you know, it's, again, we're very fortunate that we kind of stay put grow our roots, you know, sort of committed to the same goal. But then, you know, back to the conversation about invitation, it has been so fascinating to kind of always, of course, invite everybody and try to make it so that everyone can walk up the flights there, sorry, and not see something, but of course, not everything suits people, so you have to be very careful about protecting the aesthetics that is our mission and that what's, you know, started with.
time goes by and you think to yourself, you look back, well, we did this years ago, but then it doesn't really make a difference. They don't want to guess a certain people.
It does. Sorry, I'm going to tell you it does. We've done now since, I guess we're in the fourth year, for every run, there's at least one, sometimes more, Spanish translation offer. Sometimes it's not even used.
Right.
But people get to know. Making yourself clear to people when you're inviting takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
You have to invite people sometimes 10 times before they even trust you enough to consider it.
I want to ask you about that, because that really resonates a lot for me. I think that, and I'm sure it resonates for a lot of people, which is that, when you do come from a place of access to resources, and for a lot of settlers here the other day, you talk about sort of radical share, and they let you have resources and share them. And I think that's, for a lot of us in this table, that's actually a core, value. It's like, well, if I have access to these resources, it's worth that I share them with others. And I'm not trying to come in a place of saying, I can empower you, rather just, I happen to have access to these resources, but at the same time, acknowledge that it's hard to build trust, and it's hard to build new relationships, and it's hard to, that invitation to, Laura Shapiro is here today, she's a wonderful artist who is, really struggling as an African, from Africa, from Zimbabwe, struggling with, trying to, this country, being asked to identify as Black, or being otherized as African, and also wanting to have her work reach out to other people from continental Africa in community in New York, and them, and then the ban of those places not having the trust of those communities to be able to invite them into experience this work. So I'm wondering, how does trust happen? In the short term, the long term, in language, in aesthetics, Dustin Bose was here, that was a wonderful show. I feel like it really hit a great point of, I don't know.
A big point on it.
It was a really, really solid show that both embraced the Seku's aesthetics and the sort of more popular community aesthetics from which the work came, but it also had great performers and was authentic. It wasn't some sort of performance of an identity.
Yeah, I feel like I'd be interested to hear maybe a little bit from who have maybe marketing efforts, because I'd say, as someone also who works in the assembly, the thing I know how to do as a director is to build trust among small groups of people, and I think about this a lot in many, I do have a lot of ideas of how I think theater should work, and I can enact them in a small group, but I think for us, we don't have the tools or the experience really. I don't know how to reach out to many different communities, and I'm just curious if there are very specific ways that people have found have been successful or have been really.
Can I say something to you? I think if you focus there, you're going to get lost. It's bigger. I really feel I know, because I have to invite people to things all the time. And we also don't have a space. You don't have a space, right? So it's not like there's a place for it. But I think that this idea of invitation attached to marketing is what really gets us fucked up. And so if you kind of iris back and you think about what's inside the work, what are you making that you want other people to talk to you about? And you can't involve everybody all the time. You can't. Sometimes you can. You can involve lots of people in making, and we do. But there's different ways of making. We have to be careful we don't end up in this pendulum swing where the only good art now is art that is one way or another way. It's a spectrum.
Say that the piece that's what's being made isn't necessarily the play all the time, or the show, or the performance, whatever. In other words, when you were just now talking about about how do you, you know, you have skills, you know how to build something with the actors. How is there, I felt like you were saying, is there kind of a clue in that, how you build something bigger with this larger community? And I'd say Gordon Pottinger is someone who knows how to do that, sitting over there. So hopefully she'll come here in a minute and talk about some of the ways she does that. Michael Rode has written a lot about how he does that. And he talks, he makes the distinction between civic practice and social practice. And he's, I mean, different people make that distinction differently. For performance people, I find the way he makes it really useful. He says when someone invites him in to take his skills and use it in a context which is not a performance context, that's civic practice, he could use those same skills when he invites other people in, and then the context is a performance. And an example is he's been working a couple of years with Catholic Charities. And here are these people all over the country, it's this enormous organization, and they come together at a big national convening once a year. But they still feel very splintered from each other. And so someone found out about him, I don't know how, Father somebody from Catholic Charities found out about him and said, could you use some of the skills you use to build community in theater, to build community in Catholic Charities? And he does now. He's been working in their conference, big conference and little conference. So one thing is, I think we live in a great time to question what is the whole thing. And it doesn't, it's not either or, it's not just stop.
Correct.
Please don't stop making performance. You all make beautiful performances. I would be bereft. So many of us would be bereft. But you don't have, that does not have to be the frame for the whole thing. One of the exciting things now is I feel that artists are being invited to claim what really drives them. And for somebody, it might be involved in municipal government. And, you know, here to Miss May has been quoted talking about the importance of her religious upbringing. And she wants to make the kingdom of heaven on the stage. She's still in place. But how we bring the several things we care about is this larger way. And we can't do it necessarily with the usual suspects. So we're not doing anyone a favor by reaching out. And I think that's really important. It's a feeling that here's this thing I want to do and I can't do it without whatever it is.
What necessary things?
The assumption that you're inviting people to something that is valid to them.
Necessary. I'm going to say it over and over because I think your shared magnetic, shared sense of necessity is absolutely correct.
That's right.
I think, but it's a small thing.
But I also think it's really important that people don't feel that the theater or performance venue is a intimidating, scary place. I walk into theater sometimes and I see a lot of shows and I walk in and I can, it's like you smell like a fart in a car. You're like, you know, you're about to talk something. And that is really sort of off-putting, especially, so think about it, if you're from someone who does see a lot of performance and you don't, oh, why would you want to be there? But just to speak to what you were saying, Jan and Jess, you know, I'm from Central Highwayman, and we noticed a large shift in our audiences. And I think that it's important to distinguish when we're talking about audiences versus artists, because like, even though I think it is the same relative conversation about invitation and participation and social or civic engagement, there is a difference of what those conversations are. But our audiences dramatically shifted when our casting dramatically shifted. It wasn't intentional. You know, we started working with certain people, certain performers, and then all of a sudden realized that we didn't have small houses made up of black turtlenecks, you know, for lack of a better description. You know, it's people's parents, it's their cousins, it's their next door neighbors who are coming to see them in a play. And I think that there's something, while it is great to create a theatrical environment that feels necessary and important and vital and valuable, and those words are good. I also think it's important that it feels open and fun and playful. That it's not intimidating. That someone's uncle can come see them in a play because there's my nephew on stage and this is fun. And not that we have to make saccharine sweet, easy plays, but that it has to be in some capacity. Actually, I think it was Mark Yeoman who said at the keynote address, or the symposium of Under the Radar, that if it's, I think it was him, I'm going to give credit. that if it's not well made, it can't be received. People who sort of say, well, you didn't get it, or it wasn't, da 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 da. No, that's a sign that it wasn't constructed well. It should be, we're not talking about dumbing down, we're talking about well constructing the art itself so that it involves the invitation of different perspectives.
I'm so sorry, I derailed. Can I just say I derailed you? I tried to piggyback on you. That derailed. So, what were you going to say?
No, I mean, I was listening to Abby, and I'm just remembering sitting in my office, which is really closet, behind the wall of our theater, and hearing the opening of Godot performed by 10 more boys. You know, and
I cut the suicide masturbation.
Thank you.